Hello and a very warm welcome to episode 30 of the Green Bean Podcast. My name is Katie and this is Jack, and we've been sitting here recording these podcasts for you now for 3 years, which is incredible to me. It feels like no time at all since I sat in this room very nervous and switched on my camera for the first time and started talking about my drawing, knitting and sewing. And here we are, 3 years later. So huge thanks to you if you've been with me for all of that journey, and a very warm welcome if this is the first time that you're watching. I've decided to do a slightly different episode this time, just to celebrate. 30 episodes feels like a huge milestone, and it's actually more if you count the episodes that I've shared on Patreon. That's probably closer to 50 episodes altogether, which is just brilliant. I feel really proud to have got to that stage after being so nervous to sit down and record the first one. So huge thanks to everyone who's been supporting me and cheering me on along the way, and especially to supporters on Patreon who made it possible. When I first started recording podcasts, I was doing it alongside working my full-time job, and since then I've been able to leave that job and become a full-time artist, which is what I always wanted to do. So in this episode, I thought I would talk a little bit about that. I'm going to share a bit about my journey to becoming a full-time artist, my education and my history, and all of the stories about how I came to be drawing for a living. And I thought I'd also share my very first knitted garment and my first sewn garment, as well as the usual walk out on Dartmoor with me and little Jack. So settle in with a nice cup of tea or coffee and a project to work on, and I hope you enjoy the episode. Thank you. Rather than talking about what I'm currently working on in this 30th episode, I thought I would take a bit of a pause and share with you a story, or at least some of the story of how I came to be doing what I'm doing these days. And by what I'm doing, I mean sharing videos on YouTube of my various different creative processes and selling products on Etsy of my illustrations. Because it's been a kind of long and roundabout route, and I feel like I've shared bits and pieces of the story here and there on the podcast before, but perhaps people don't know very much about my background. So I thought I'd take the opportunity to go back a few years and talk you through the process of how I ended up here. And I'm cautious that I don't want to make this too waffly, so I'm going to try and keep it reasonably brief. It's worth saying that when I was a kid, I knew that I always wanted to make books, and I wasn't particularly fussed about what kind of books, whether they were written or illustrated. Books was what I wanted to do, and I kind of got sidetracked at school. I ended up being pushed towards more academic studies. I focused on sciences and I did a degree in biology before I went back to art college and retrained in illustration. So that kind of takes you through my teens and early 20s. And I graduated from Swindon College with illustration, sequential illustration was the title of my degree. So I was particularly focused on comics. And it was the thought that I wanted to create my graphic memoir, Lighter Than My Shadow, that really inspired me and got me through art college. I had this very fixed idea in my mind of that rather huge project that I wanted to take on. And I was very fortunate that straight after art college, I found a publisher for that project and spent the subsequent 5 years really working on that and bringing that out into the world. And in the meantime, while I was working on that, I also started self-publishing zines and selling a few products in my Etsy shop. So that all started in 2009. And I was doing that whilst also working part-time in a craft shop. So I was kind of juggling lots of things and all sorts was going on. And eventually I had to kind of rein it back in and just focus on delivering that book for the deadline. So the book, if I haven't talked about it, I don't think I've talked about it recently, so you may not know what I'm talking about. It is a 500 page graphic memoir of my struggles with eating disorders and sexual abuse. So no small subject and no small book. It was a humongous project, and it filled my life for the time that I was working on it, and many years before and many years afterwards. It took a huge recovery process to get over writing that book, and I was prepared for that to some extent, but I don't think fully. I really poured all of the love and energy and dedication that I had into that project, and after I'd finished it, I was creatively, physically, and emotionally exhausted. I ended up taking several years break from illustration after finishing that book. It was a real difficult struggle for me because I had been, you know, working on it with the idea that that book would be what launched my career, and actually I didn't have any energy left for my career after finishing the book. It was such a humongous project. So I got to travel around a bit and promote the book and do things like that, which was brilliant, but I also had to work in other jobs in order to make enough income, and I felt strangely ashamed of that. That was a real struggle for me. I think we have this idea, this kind of cultural perception of authors as different from normal people, or like on a pedestal, a step above, and I don't know, I really struggled with the idea that people would see me as successful because I had a published book. But then I also felt ashamed of the fact that I wasn't making a living from doing my creative work, if that makes sense. So I had a real kind of tussle with myself about that for several years. And that's how I ended up working in the knitting industry. I started doing some comics and bits and pieces for Pom Pom Quarterly magazine, and then I ended up working full-time for a knitting company, a yarn producing company, doing marketing and stuff like that. And that was where I learned how to write knitting patterns, and kind of that fostered a bit more of my confidence in my creativity again. It was during that time that I started making podcasts, and that's where you will have joined me. If you joined me at the beginning of my podcasting journey 3 years ago, I was still working that full-time job, but just tentatively, gently thinking about whether I might be able to take my illustration work back to being my full-time occupation. And here we are, 3 years later, incredibly. I'm sitting here chatting to my camera, and it is through this podcast and sharing my work on YouTube that I've been able to make this my full-time job again, and it feels like such a gift. I'm just so honoured that you're here, that you enjoy watching and listening and hearing about the work that I'm doing. Particularly those of you who support on Patreon, who really make this financially possible. It's just been such an unexpected joy. I never would have thought that making videos would be how I spent so much of my creative time, but it turns out I really, really enjoy that process. It's a different kind of storytelling, and I realised that storytelling is actually what I love my work to be about, and it goes back to being that little kid again and those little stapled together books that I started making. I feel like making videos gives me that same kind of excitement. So who knows where we go from here. I've got no intention of stopping making videos anytime soon, that's for sure. I really enjoy that being part of my creative practice. But in terms of comics, I always thought that Lighter Than My Shadow would be the first of many big books, and I've learned from that process that maybe big, and by big I mean 500 page books, isn't that great for me in terms of mental health, shall we say. So I'm not sure what kind of direction I'm going to take that part of my practice in. I do really enjoy creating smaller illustrations for products and that kind of thing, and I love sharing that here on YouTube, but sometimes I am also craving getting my teeth into something a bit bigger, something slightly longer term. So I'm just kind of entertaining that thought gently, not putting too much pressure on it because then it gets scary. But yeah, waiting and seeing what might evolve and what might happen over the next few years. It's going to be interesting, but whatever it is, I'm looking forward to sharing it with you. I asked patrons what particular aspects they might like me to talk about in this special episode, and someone asked for a more in-depth look at my background with scratchboard illustration. And I thought that would be an interesting thing to focus in on, because it was a medium that I didn't know anything about, I didn't touch at art college, or before working on my book Lighter Than My Shadow. It's something that has been part of this, what I feel like is the second stage of my illustration career, and I picked it up after I moved from Bristol down to Devon, which is in the West Country, and was really changing the way I was thinking about illustrating. So I thought I'd show you the very first scratchboard illustration I did. I unfortunately don't have the original because I gave it to the musician as a gift. So I created a poster for one of my favourite musicians, Alasdair Roberts, who's actually, it's his music that you hear in the introduction and closing sequence of every episode of the Green Bean podcast. He was playing at a small venue close to where we live, and I was given the chance to design a poster for that. And for reasons that I will never know, I decided to use scratchboard for it. Actually, it wasn't even scratchboard, it was scraper foil. So whereas scratchboard is a layer of white and a layer of black, and you scrape off the black to reveal the white underneath, the foil ones come in different shades, but it's a metallic surface underneath. So the one I chose was silver. It also comes in copper, gold, multicolored, hideous, holographic, whatever you want. But I chose the silver, and having never worked in this medium before, this is quite typical of me. If you have followed me for a long time, you'll know. Threw myself in the deep end. I was like, right, I'm going to design this beautiful poster. And I spent weeks on it. Like, this is the privilege of having illustration be a hobby and not a full-time job. So this was when I was working other jobs alongside. I was able to take weeks and weeks over a commission, really learning my process, getting used to those meticulous details. And I loved it as a medium. It was really fun to work with. What I did learn from that project was that if you use the metallic scratch board, you cannot scan the illustration. The way that the light reflects when you put it in a scanner means that the image won't show up. So I then had, when I finished it, I had to go and pay for it to be professionally photographed so that I could have a digital image. So that was frustrating. And ever since then, I've been using the white scratch board, and I used it for various pieces. One of my favourite pieces was a comic called Bowerbird that was originally published in Pom Pom Quarterly magazine, and it's now available in one of my zines that I self-published. I collected all the different mini comics that I did for Pom Pom in that zine. And again, that was a commission that I took far longer than was necessary over, because I was just really enjoying getting into the details of the process. I absolutely love how scratchboard really lets you focus on those tiny details, but it shows up in really bright contrast. There's something about making white marks on black rather than making black marks on white paper that's really different and intriguing, and I love working with it. Also at that time, I started work on a huge piece of scratchboard, a huge like A2 piece based on penguins. And it came to my attention recently that I never actually finished that piece. So I've pulled that out from under the bed and discovered there's very little left to be done on those poor penguins to bring them to life. I don't know why, I was having a thing about penguins at the time, and I decided to create this illustration of all the different penguin species. And yeah, when I pulled it out of the bed, I discovered there were just a few details that needed finishing off to turn that into a poster or a print, which it was always intended to be. So I decided to pull those penguins out and give them a new life, because why not? They deserve to be finished. So rather than show you what I'm working on now, I have pulled out my first ever knitted garment to share with you. And let's be clear, it's not my first ever knitting project. I knitted various toys, accessories, those kind of small things before I started garment knitting. But it was really the idea of knitting garments that got me deeply into knitting. I went from somebody who could knit to being a knitter when I started making my own clothes. That was a really kind of exciting and huge step forward for me. And this jumper is special and sentimental for lots of reasons. It includes a lot of firsts. Obviously, it's my first garment. It also represents yarn that I bought at my very first yarn festival, my first indie dyed yarn, loads of special things about this project. So it's really meaningful in a lot of respects. So let's start with the yarn. I purchased the yarn at my very first Yarndale, which is a festival in Yorkshire in the UK. And I went there in 2014 for the first time. I think that was the second year that the festival ran. I think it started in 2013. And I went there with my friend Sarah, and I had never been to a yarn festival before. I had no idea of the size and enthusiasm of the knitting and crochet community in the UK at all. I kind of had got into knitting through learning from my grandma and buying books, finding yarn in department stores, that kind of thing. I had no idea that there were so many independent producers, farmers, indie dyers, that kind of thing. So Yarndale was a huge eye-opening experience for me, and let's be honest, wallet-opening experience as well. I bought a lot of yarn that weekend, and this green yarn was the very first purchase that I made on that day. So it felt really special. I had no plans. This is something that has changed for me since then quite a lot. Now I will always buy yarn, not with a specific pattern in mind, but at least with an idea of the kind of project I might make with it, so that I buy a sensible quantity. In this case, I bought the yarn because I really loved it. I loved the colour, I loved the texture of it. I knew I wanted it to be a garment, but I wasn't sure of quantity, so I bought four humongous skeins. So it's a woolen spun four ply yarn, although it's on the heavier side. I'd call it more like a sport weight yarn. And it's from a dyer called JillyBean, who I don't think is dyeing anymore, certainly not at the moment. But it's fleeces from a British flock, and as I say, woolen spun, hand dyed in this incredibly bright green colour. And I'll try and capture some shots of it that really show you how the colour glows when it's in natural light. It's really just stunning, and you'll see why I fell in love with it immediately. But it didn't have a pattern in mind for the project. So as I say, I bought four humongous skeins, which was too much. This jumper took three skeins, so I have a whole skein left over somewhere, I have no idea where, that I will use for something else at some point. But I decided on this project because I had had my eye on the jumper. I quite liked the pattern. It's called Moray Star by Di Gilpin, but I don't think I would recommend the pattern for one major reason, and that's that it only includes one size, which is, in my opinion, not really good enough. Who's that going to fit? Nobody. And the answer, the truth is, it didn't fit me either. So the pattern is written for a 36 inch bust, which I do not have. But at that stage in my knitting journey, I didn't have the confidence or the knowledge to be making changes to patterns or altering patterns. So I went with it. I knitted the one size available in the pattern, and I have a jumper that looks like it fits, right? No. So what happens is the jumper is cast on at the hem, and you knit upwards to the underarms in the round. Then you separate and knit the front and the back pieces flat and join them at the shoulders. The sleeves are then cast on at the cuff, knitted in the round, and then seamed around the shoulders. What happened with my fit was that, I ended up with a huge amount of extra fabric under the arms. I'm talking inches, so it was probably out here, and the sleeve would have been way off in this direction. So what I actually have is some rather chunky false seams in the side. There's several inches of extra fabric tucked away inside here. So when I'm wearing it, it feels pretty bulky under the arms. I've not bothered doing anything about fixing that in all the time that I've had this jumper. So yeah, in order to make it fit, I had to do some false seams, and that improved the sleeves a little bit, but as you can see, they're still a little bit too long, and you can tell that because they're starting to come apart at the cuff through wear and tear and me fiddling with it. So if I made the jumper again, which I wouldn't, but if I did, I would also shorten the sleeves because they're not quite ideal. The other thing that I don't love about it is the neckline. It's a little bit wide for me. Sometimes it falls off one shoulder. It's just got a little bit too much slack. So all in all, there's lots of things about the jumper that are not perfect. But for a first garment, it's pretty good, I reckon. And, you know, not only my first garment, but the first time I did cables, the first time I did any lace, I really threw myself in the deep end. There's all sorts of things going on in this jumper. And I think that's one of the reasons why I get a lot of compliments when I wear it. It's an impressive looking knit. There's kind of knit and purl, Gansey texture in the middle, lace across the shoulders, cables and lace on the sleeves. There's a lot going on. But, you know, if you don't like the garment, you don't like the garment. And sadly, this one sits in my wardrobe and doesn't often get worn because it just, the fit doesn't feel as comfortable as I would like. So what I've been thinking is that I would frog it and use this beautiful yarn for something else. Because I've had this jumper for, what, 6-7 years now? There's not a sign of pilling on the yarn. It's wearing really well. So I feel like it deserves to become something else. But I did want to pull it out and show it to you and chat to you about it before I begin the process of transformation. One more thing that I wanted to show you, a confession before I unravel the jumper, is this huge hole under the arm, which has been there for years. It's not the jumper unraveling, it's just my poor seaming. I'd never done any seaming before. So yeah, every time I wear it, there's just this huge drafty hole under the arm as well. So I think it's time for this jumper to be released from duty and turn into something else. continuing the theme of first garments, I thought that I would chat to you about my first ever sewn garment. Again, it was a real kind of light bulb moment for me in the process of sewing. I had always sewn. I learned to sew at primary school and with my grandma. But again, I had made kind of accessories, bags, cushion covers, that kind of thing. And it wasn't until I started I took the plunge into making my own clothes that I got really, really excited about sewing. I've always been interested in and excited by clothes, so it made sense that the idea of making my own would be what really got me going and motivated me. Unfortunately, I don't have my first ever sewn garment to show you. I donated it, but I can chat to you about it nonetheless. So it was a fancy dress costume. I can't remember the name of the pattern, but I'm going to pop the name of it and a link down below. It was basically, I was employed in a place where when we had special events and occasions, the staff were encouraged to wear fancy dress. And not everybody got as excited about it as I did, but on all other occasions, we just had to wear black. And you might have noticed that you never see me wearing black. I do not like wearing black. So I just felt every time I put that uniform on, I just felt kind of heavy and bleh. So the excitement of getting to go to work in fancy dress was very major for me, and enough to get me thinking, well, I can't afford to buy the fancy dress costume that I want, so why don't I make it? And I did. So we had an apple festival, and I decided to make, this is going to make you laugh, as my first ever garment, a square-necked medieval dress with a like an overdress, lace-up corset type front, boning in the corset, no holds barred. This was a really serious first sewing project, and I don't know what made me feel like I could take this on as a first project. I think because it was fancy dress, I felt like it didn't matter too much if I messed it up, so long as the garments stayed together for the day that I was going to wear it, that would be fine, right? What's the worst that could happen? So I made the garment following a step-by-step tutorial for the exact pattern from Professor Pincushion on YouTube. I was literally kind of pausing it after every single step. I had barely used my sewing machine before that point. There were loads of techniques that I hadn't come across before, but the tutorial was really detailed, and because it was exactly specific to the pattern I was following, it made it really straightforward, and that just kind of lit up all of these possibilities in my mind of, well, if I can follow this pattern, then now I understand what I need to do to follow any other given sewing pattern. So I just felt like so many possibilities opened up to me as a result of taking on that ridiculously complicated first sewing project. And I kind of feel sad that I didn't keep it, even though it's not something I would wear every day. It certainly taught me a lot, and I felt amazing when I wore it. I don't think that people really knew that I had sewn it by hand from scratch as my first sewing project, but I guess that's a compliment, isn't it? You don't want people to look at your handmade clothes and be like, oh, that's nice, did you make it? You want them to say, oh, that's nice, and then you are the one who says, oh, thanks, I made it. So, yeah, I was ridiculously proud of that project, and it made me feel like I had the confidence to start sewing some real clothes for my real wardrobe. And what I'm wearing is the second garment that I made for myself. It's a dress based on this pattern, Simplicity 1610. And I purchased it because it says Project Runway on it. And I don't know about you, but I'm a huge Project Runway fan. It was one of my favourite TV shows, and Tim Gunn is one of my favourite people. So, yeah, obviously watching a lot of Project Runway definitely inspired me to get sewing as well. So I'm slightly uncomfortable sitting here in this dress. It's not necessarily a style that I would choose anymore. It's also a wee bit small, I'm going to be honest. I've changed sizes a little bit since I made it. But there's lots about it that I can still be proud of. And as I say, I don't wear it because it doesn't really fit in my wardrobe. It's a proper party dress. And I mean, I don't know. I don't know what I was thinking when I decided to make this. It's something that's changed a lot over the last few years of sewing, is really understanding what kind of pieces I wear, what fits into my wardrobe, what I gravitate towards every day, particularly with my lifestyle, which is mostly being at home. And when I am out, I'm out on the moors, walking the dog, wearing boots, getting muddy, slim-fitting party dresses don't have a huge part to play in that wardrobe. So even when it did fit, it wasn't getting a lot of wear. But I do love it. The fabric is a quilting cotton. It came from Brooklyn General Store on one of my trips to New York many, many years ago. And I think I must have intended to make a dress out of it because I had, probably about 3 yards, quite a generous amount of fabric. So I knew I was intending to make a garment with it. And the thing I'm most proud of about this dress is that I bothered matching the pattern. So not only is it nice and central at the front, it matches either side of the zip at the back, and the centre back seam all the way down the skirt is pattern matched as well. Possibly excessive pattern matching, but I was, you know, even in that early stage of sewing, I was really meticulous, and possibly more meticulous than I am these days, if I'm honest. I'm a little bit more gung-ho and relaxed with my sewing these days, but when I was first learning, I was really taking it slowly, being very particular about the way things came together. And I ended up with a dress that I'm pretty proud of. Me being me, it is fully lined, also in quilting cotton, so the whole thing feels pretty stiff and bulky, but I love the fact that it's got this coordinating colour on the inside. It has pockets. I'm just gonna turn around and show you the back. And an invisible zip. So even at that early stage, I was putting zips in my clothes. It's only since then that I've really realised that A, I don't like wearing things with zips in, and B, I don't like sewing things with zips in either. I've been completely liberated by making clothes that are less form-fitting because I can just put them over my head and be done with it. But nonetheless, this is a pretty prideful project, and I don't know what I'm going to do with the fabric because I don't wear it. It's a little tight to be comfortable, and as I say, it doesn't really fit with my lifestyle anymore. And that's not to say that you can't wear a party dress out walking on the moors if you want to, but I just don't wear it. And so I've been thinking that I might cut up the fabric and use it for like a project bag, or use some pieces in a quilt, that kind of thing. I'm open to suggestions. I don't really know. I do really love the fabric, so it'd be nice to use it for something. But I thought it would be fun to talk about some of my earlier sewing adventures with you. And I wanted to share them because, I don't know, I think we can have this idea that to start sewing, you have to start with something really simple and straightforward, and there's a lot to be said for that. But for me, the approach that worked was really throwing myself in the deep end and letting go of all of the fear that I had of, well, what if I do it wrong? What if it's not good enough? I learned so much by taking on a project that was arguably far bigger than a beginner should be taking on. Just by giving it a go. And okay, the resulting things aren't perfect and haven't become staple parts of my wardrobe, but they were really important stepping stones in the process to me being able to make clothes that really are staples and part of my everyday wardrobe. So if you're someone who hasn't taken the leap and started sewing garments yet, why not give it a go? It is just so incredibly satisfying, and I haven't looked back since that first weird corset costume that I made. Thank you so much for joining us for this special 30th episode of the Green Bean Podcast. I hope you've enjoyed hearing a bit of history and background to my creative processes. If you want to find my products, I've popped a link down below to my Etsy shop and also to my Patreon, where you can access all of the extra episodes and vlogs that I share with supporters of the podcast. You can also find me on Instagram as Katie Greenbean, and I will see you very soon for the next episode. Thank you so much for watching. Take care. Bye.